please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Well, that is Indira Jaisingh there responding to what has been an unprecedented morning, an unprecedented afternoon here in the national capital, with four sitting judges of the Supreme Court coming out and saying that things are not well within the apex court, and they have raised the matter with the Chief Justice of India in the past, including this morning, but they haven't been able to find any remedial measures. Kamini Jaiswal, we just heard Indira Jaisingh there and asking some pertinent questions which we would like answers to. Indira Jaisingh saying she wants to know, why has there been a divide between the Chief Justice of India and his four colleagues? She wants to know if there is any indication to suggest that there has been interference of the executive in the matters of the judiciary. Are those questions that you would like answers to as well?
Sorry, yeah, yes, No. I know what is there. Why should I ask questions here? The divide is that, you know, you don't respect your number two. I mean, I know there was a matter where number two said listed before the five senior most judges. He was, and his order was completely ignored. A backdated order is passed, and the matter is listed to number nine, six or seven. You know, this kind of, you can't disrespect your judges. They're all equal. They're all Supreme Court judges. You can't misbehave with them like this.
Madam,
judges are being 2, 3, 4, 5 are completely ignored.
Yeah.
And you pick up matters and put them to court 6 and 8 and 10 and 12.
Yeah. Madam Jaiswal, Prashant here, just quick thing. So you are saying this is essentially a matter of distrust between the judges, right? I mean, the Chief Justice...
No, it is disrespect.
Disrespect?
And, you know, kind of being disrespect for your brother judge.
Yes.
Your brother judge is as... He is also a Supreme Court judge. You can't do this to them.
Okay.
Just because you happen to be Chief Justice and you... Chief Justice only can allocate. Otherwise, the law is you are one amongst equals.
Uh-huh.
And the judges, and you can't pick up matters from one bench and put it in another bench because you want a particular kind of an order.
Okay.
Or a particular kind of result.
Ms. Jaiswal, if you can just stay on, Mohan Parasaran, former Solicitor General, has also joined us. Mr. Parasaran, how would you interpret what you saw today, the four judges speaking out but not entirely telling us what they were against? It's quite clearly the assignment of cases that they are referring to. What are your first comments on this? Mr. Parasaran? Okay, well, the lines are playing hooky today. Ms. Jaiswal, is there an executive interference angle? Okay, well, we will be getting Kamini Jaiswal again. Just difficult to get the key people involved. There are two angles.
Mr. Parasaran is back.
Okay, Mr. Parasaran, if you can hear me, sir, your first reaction to the four chief justices speaking out to the press? No. Well, we are not able to get... Okay, Mr. Parasaran, can you hear me? Okay, okay. Well, we will reconnect to the leading legal lights, but this is casting serious aspersions on the working of the Supreme Court at a time when key issues are being faced or will come up to the Supreme Court, cases probably relating to bankruptcy, cases probably relating to other constitutional matters. So the Supreme Court needs to function in a normal way. The judges are not showing protest about that. The last thing that Chalameshwar told us, the last thing that the judges told us is that they're going back to court to do their work. So it's not as if work will come to a standstill, but nevertheless, this could impede the smooth functioning of the Supreme Court. One hopes that this will be a quick end to this distrust between the Chief Justice and his four immediate juniors. I believe Mohan Parasaran is back with us. Mr. Parasaran, your reactions to what you saw from the four chief justices, from the four judges of the Supreme Court?
See, this is rather unfortunate, and I think we're left with no other alternative.
Mm.
And out of sheer desperation and the interest of protecting the institution, the four judges have come to the public. And they have given a concrete illustration with regard to a matter, but the reputation of the Supreme Court is at the lowest ebb now, and all of us will have to actually take a deep introspection. The Chief Justice of India and the other judges also owe a lot of explanation to the country.
Mr. Parasaran, you're saying the reputation of the Supreme Court is at its lowest ebb, and you're not surprised by what has transpired this afternoon. What gives you cause for grievance, sir? What have you been most dissatisfied with?
See, there have been rumors all these days, no, with regard to disposal of matters, posting of matters before some benches, and hearing of some matters, favoritism, and bowing to political pressure. But now when four judges come out openly, I think there is something rotten, no, with the system.
Hmm. You're saying that you believe that the manner in which things have transpired over the last few months suggests that there is something rotten in the system. But what happens from here on, sir? Because for lay people like me, this looks like a no confidence motion against the Chief Justice of India virtually on broadcast television. Where does this leave the Supreme Court, and where do we go from here?
We have to wait. No, how actually the political parties are going to view, the parliamentarians are going to view the matter, because judges can't impeach judges.
So that
he's the parents' petty.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, this matter would require some sort of explanation.
That was exactly my question, sir. Does this look like it will be resolved within the judiciary itself? And if there is executive interference,
can be. I hope it is resolved within the judiciary. That will be the best thing which can happen to the institution, no?
Mm.
Because the common man ultimately has only faith in this institution.
Yes.
And if this institution, I think there is a war, I think the country will be shown a very poor light.
Mm.
And the common man will be actually very disappointed.
Mm. Don't you fear, sir, if there is an executive interference to resolve the case, either ways it will be seen as partisan. So would you say that...
Executive, I think, has been partially responsible for all this, I think.
Okay. So that means executive interference will come even to resolve,
I think so.
How is executive responsible for this, Mr. Parasaran? Why are you saying
I can't comment too much, but I think executive has been responsible, I think, in the manner in which some my matters have been listed and disposed of. That is the inference one can draw.
Mm.
From what has been discussed.
No, so that is a very serious point that you're making, Mr. Parasaran. You're saying the Chief Justice decides benches, who gets assigned what, and you're saying the executive may have had a role. I mean, is that essentially...
That is an inference. That could be a reasonable inference, but we'll have to wait and see what the executive also does.
In which case, the executive may align itself with the Chief Justice, is your fear?
Yeah, can align. We'll have to wait and see. So far, they're not reacted. Let us wait and see.
Uh-huh.
Okay. What are you expecting by way of a reaction from the executive, sir?
Normally, I think somebody should have reacted in such a serious situation.
Mm.
But we'll wait for the reaction, no?
Well, we don't know what that reaction is going to be. The letter is now with us. I've just got the first page of that letter. So, Mr. Parasaran, let me get you to respond to that. Dear Chief Justice, it is with great anguish and concern that we have thought it proper to address this letter to you to highlight certain judicial orders passed by this court, which has adversely affected the overall functioning of the justice delivery system and the independence of the high courts, besides impacting the administrative functioning of the offices of the Honorable Chief Justice of India. So, Mr. Parasaran, very clearly here, they're also highlighting the fact that the independence of high courts, they feel, has been compromised. That is the first paragraph from page one of this letter. So it's not just about the matters within the Supreme Court. They're also saying that the independence of high courts seems to have been compromised. That is the message there from page one of that letter. Our colleague Ashmit Kumar, who's at that press conference with us. Ashmit, do you have more details of that letter?
Okay. Well, we're still awaiting a final word. The letter, Justice Telemeshwar, while addressing the press conference, did not come with a copy of that letter. It is only now being distributed. We're getting a copy of that. What's important, however, is that the tone and the tenor with which the four senior most judges, that's the entire strength of the collegium minus the chief, are addressing the press conference. They made it very, very clear that these are dark times. They're not calling it a protest. On being asked a very pointed question, if this is a protest, if this is a mutiny, they're denying that, they're refusing that. But this, we need to keep in mind that this is unprecedented. For the first time, do we have all the members of the collegium minus the chief addressing the press conference and raising a very, very pointed question. Now, Justice Gogoi, importantly, as a part of the press conference, when asked a very pointed question that the concerns raised, did it have anything to do with the case pertaining to Justice Loya's death? There was an application that was filed before the Apex Court. In fact, only minutes back it was heard. To that, his answer was that, yes, this was the concern raised. This was the issue based on which the four judges had written to the chief and had raised concerns about how the matter had been assigned. That is the moot point here. That does appear to be the tipping point as to the assignment of the case, the bench to which it was assigned. Keep in mind that the Chief Justice of India is the master of the roster. He gets to decide which case gets listed before which judge. That's called the assignment. That is something that the four judges appear to have taken exception to, have raised this concern before the Chief Justice. And as you heard just minutes back, that they've said that those concerns were not met with any actionable responses from the chief, that his response in turn raised more questions. What's also critical here is that the first reaction that we got was from senior advocate Indra Jaisingh. And one issue that she raised is that if this issue does pertain to the issue of assignment of Justice Loya's case, that gives rise to a larger question, that are there external pressures on the Indian judiciary at the highest level? That's one question that the judges for now are evading. They're saying that this is only to the effect that they want to highlight for the nation. They're not responding to that question, but that is one key question that was raised by the senior advocate, that are there external pressures that are now mounting on the functioning of the Indian judiciary?
Just hang on, Ashmit. I believe Prashant has some important information to share. Prashant.
Shireen, you know, I spoke with a very senior sort of source in the top court, the Supreme Court. What I was told is that over the last, and this is not now the last 1 week or the last 2 weeks, but over the last couple of months, there was immense dissatisfaction which was brewing. What I was told is that other senior judges, I mean equally senior judges of the Supreme Court, apart from these four judges, some of them tried to tell Justice Chamleshwar that let's settle the matter within the court. Let's not take the grievances public. And this happened roughly around the time when questions of probity, etc., were raised, against the Chief Justice of India, where those two benches were constituted, etc. So there was a lot of effort which was made by other senior judges of the Supreme Court to try and tell the dissatisfied dissatisfied members, including Justice Chamleshwar, to try and resolve the matter within the court. And one of the reasons they gave while doing this is that if you open up the judiciary in this manner, in terms of voicing your grievances in public, what is going to happen is you're going to open the door. And the executive may get a foot in the door firmly.
Okay. Mohan Parasaran told us, probably the executive has already put the foot in the door. And
now, that's a very serious inference to make, which he
exactly.
said.
Exactly. If that is the case, that explains why the markets are falling so much. This is one of the greatest institutions. If that is going to be attacked, this will, raise huge questions. I'm not surprised that the market is losing ground at this point in time. Political stability and legal stability is about the best that this country had in terms of judicial and legal stability.
What I was told regards to the interference of the executive essentially was that as of now, what I was told is what the executive is doing in a way to impede the judiciary is that it's sitting on judges' appointment. That is all that I was told.
I don't think Parasaran is...
He's going ahead.
Nor Kamini Jaiswal were hinting only to that much. They are going beyond it.
Yeah.
Yeah, go ahead, Chiri.
I think I think if you look at the letter, if you look at the letter as well, they seem to be suggesting benches of their preference without rational basis for such assignment. This must be guarded against at all costs. So they're talking about benches being set up with clearly preferential treatment when it comes to the assignment and setting up of benches. That I'm reading out from the letter in specific. This is one of the issues that the four judges have written to the Chief Justice of India about. Guard against preference of...
The parallel for this is during Mrs. Indira Gandhi's time as Prime Minister, there was an insinuation of committed judiciary. And in an unusual case in the 70s, I can't remember the date, Justice A.N. Rai, who was not the senior most judge, was promoted as the Chief Justice of India. Now, here, what is apparently what Mohan Parasaran is hinting is that while the executive has not directly intervened, it is possible that through the Chief Justice, cases are being assigned to favorably disposed judges. If that is the charge, then it's a very serious charge. We are only inferring, and we have to still get the other 7 pages of the letter. The first page is only a backdrop, which says that traditions of Anglo-Saxon jurisprudence and practice have been followed so far. So clearly they are hinting that these traditions are being violated in the current instance.
Let me read out from the letter. We are sorry to say that of late the twin rules mentioned above have not been strictly adhered to. There have been instances where cases having far-reaching consequences for the nation and the institution had been assigned by the Chief Justice of this court selectively to the benches of their preference without any rational basis for such assignment. This must be guarded against at all costs. We are not mentioning details only to avoid embarrassing the institution, but note that such departures have already damaged the image of this institution to some extent. So I'm now reading out from the letter, Lata, this business of the benches and the assignment of benches and what the judges have said on that.
You know, there are two cases that this can take. If the executive is not already interfering, then we still don't have a very serious problem. Then we only have a problem of the second to the fifth senior most judges protesting against the way the Chief Justice is going about assignment.
That is a matter of distrust and the Chief Justice.
It would still be a judicial administration or the Supreme Court administration issue. But if the insinuation is that this is being done at the behest or along with the executive, then this is a slightly, this is a vastly more serious charge. Absolutely. And if the future resolution of this two parties happens at the behest of the executive, we have an even worse problem. My sense and hope is that there are fine legal minds within the ruling party and in the opposition, and it will not be allowed to go out of hand. The judiciary will be requested to resolve it within itself and not allowed to be resolved with the help or with the interference of the executive. That's my hope. That's the best we can hope as citizens of this country. But at the moment, that's not the best judgment that the market is passing on this. The market's expressing its disappointment very clearly that we better have our judicial system stabilized. Raising doubts at the highest level is not a good sign at all for the country. You can live with political stability, but living with judicial stability is something this country has not seen before and therefore should not be allowed to worsen. So we are still waiting for the other 6 pages. Shireen has got 2. We've got 1 page.
We have the other 6.
Please, go ahead, Shireen.
We have the other pages, Lata.
Go ahead.
It's hard to read off a phone, but I'm going to try and attempt to do that. There are 2 specific cases that they have mentioned here. One is a case with respect to R.P. Luthra, and the other, let me just try and get that out for you. In the above context, we deem it proper to address you presently with regard to the order dated 27th of October 2017 in R.P. Luthra versus Union of India to the effect that there should be no further delay in finalizing the memorandum of procedure in the larger public interest. When the memorandum of procedure was the subject matter of a decision of a constitution bench of this court and Supreme Court, advocates on record, etc., the above apart subsequent to the decision of the Constitution Bench. This is one of the matters that they have raised in specific. The Government of India has not responded to the communication, and in view of this silence, it must be taken that the Memorandum of Procedure as finalized by the Collegium has been accepted by the Government of India on the basis of this order of the Supreme Court. There was therefore no occasion for the bench to make any observation with regard to the finalization of the Memorandum of Procedure, or that issue cannot linger. So this is one of the specific instances. This is just the matter R.P. Luthra versus the Union of India, and there's another matter on the 4th of July 2017, of seven judges of this court decided in Honorable Sri Justice S.C. Karnan. In that decision referred to, two of us observed that there is a need to revisit the process of appointment of judges and to set up a mechanism for corrective measures other than impeachment. No observation was made by any of the seven learned judges with regard to the Memorandum of Procedure. So, you know, these are some of the specific instances that I was just reading out from that eight-page letter written to the Chief Justice, Lata.
Okay, you know, the core line is one of the well-settled principles is that Chief Justice is the master of the roster with a privilege to determine the roster. Necessity in multi-numbered courts for an orderly transaction of business and appropriate arrangements with respect to matters which will with which member or bench of this yes. court is required to deal with I mean, basically they are questioning.
Yeah, I think we've got KTS Tulsi.
Yes.
We've got KTS Tulsi. Let's just listen into him, Lata.
That, we are hearing that there were allegations against the Chief Justice, against the sitting Chief Justice. Those allegations took the shape of some action having been taken against a retired judge. The retired judge was arrested. Perhaps there were some recordings of a conversation, telephonic intercepts by some agency or the other. So the question really is that even if 99% there is no basis for this allegation against the Chief Justice. Nevertheless, even to clear that 1% doubt, the judge concerned himself shouldn't deal with the matter in any manner. That is my personal view. I may be wrong, but I'm greatly pained myself, because this is the greatest Supreme Court in the world, perhaps the most powerful Supreme Court in the world.
Sir, Hindi mein bas thoda jana chahenge.
Yeah, okay, well, even Mr. KTS Tulsi is playing it safe. We really now know that it is the assignment of cases and the worry that senior advocates have that cases were assigned with a prior knowledge as to who would be disposed how in judging that particular case. That is the fear that the senior advocates are telling us. We really will have to wait for more details from legal luminaries and from the government as to how this will play out. I think for the moment, we have to get back to the markets. Shireen, I will await more details from you on what exactly are the contents of the letter. We have yes. them, but we need to read them and to get a handle on what exactly is the allegation. I'll hand it over to Nigel to check out what the markets are doing. There was a dip, but it appears to have been bought.
Absolutely. You know, we went even below the 10,600 odd mark, but from there, we've quickly bounced closer around 30 points or thereabouts. You know, if you take a look at the mid cap and the small cap index as well, sharp correction is what we are seeing over there. And in fact, the total traded volumes as well should be up for you. We saw massive volumes in the last 30 to around 40 minutes. But how should you position yourself? How should you trade the Nifty? Ashwini is joining us. Ashwini, your take on the Nifty. We did breach the 10,600 mark. We have done a sharp rebound from there. 40 points from those lows. How would you trade it?
See, I don't think any of our companies will stop working because Supreme Court has a little problem. And, you know, you have to buy these dips when this is just madness. It'll keep news channels busy for a week. But I don't think the market will get impacted. In fact, we should close in the green because all the weak hands are now out. So people should just go and buy Nifty, Bank Nifty. We ourselves have bought it while it was going down. Hmm. See, these things happen in a country like India. You know, he is corrupt, she is corrupt. You know, then you get into all kinds of tussles. I think these issues get resolved. So that way people should get long. This is a good opportunity of a dip that, you know, the market is giving you.
Right.
As far as individual stocks are concerned, Z is a buy with a stop of 590, target of 615. Thomas Cook is a buy with a stop of 263, target of 278. And HCC is a buy with a stop of 41, target of 50.
All right, Ashwini, just a quick counter question on the Nifty and the Nifty Bank. If you were going long, where should your stop loss come in at? Would it be today's low?
Naturally.
Okay, all right. Thanks so much, Ashwini, for joining in. Well, Ashwini is saying that, in fact, you know, you go ahead, you buy the Nifty, you buy the Nifty Bank, and that trade seems to be playing out. Just take a look at the recovery we are seeing on the Nifty as well as the Nifty Bank. I think we should get the crisscross lines as well up for you on the screen, the advanced decline lines. If they come up for you at one point of time, you know, we were down to around 500, 550 stocks, but we were seeing a bit of a pullback from there as well. Sharp correction is what we saw. Volumes massive in the last 30 minutes odd. I think we have had closer on 20% of the day's volumes that took place. The cash market volumes, in fact, should be up for you on the screen. Massive volumes. We started the show around 20,000 crores. Now, between both the exchanges, it's nearly around 26,000 crores. So keep an eye out on that front. Well,